Good evening. It is the 5th of January, 2022, and this is my first recording for the new year. I'm Steve Altide, pastor at Park Street Christian Church in El Dorado Springs, Missouri, and I'm sharing with you tonight from my office. Thank you for inviting me into your home or office as I share tonight with you about enduring and understanding storms. Now, retired minister acquaintance Bob Russell wrote this in relationship initially to the Quad State tornadoes that both began not far from Jonesboro, Arkansas on Friday, I believe it was, the 10th of November, of December, and crossed across the Boot Hill of Missouri and then the far northwestern corner of Tennessee before entering into Kentucky and doing cataclysmic damage, particularly to the two well-known towns would be Mayfield, Kentucky and Bowling Green, Kentucky. But many small outlying towns were decimated by those tornadoes. I've seen scores of videos on YouTube about those small towns, all the way from the northeastern corner of Arkansas up into Kentucky, and at least the northern of the two tornadoes, although those two tornadoes began within just a few miles of one another, just one right after the other, and traveled northeast into the Boot Hill in between Hayti and Caruthersville, Missouri. At least the northern other two tracked that way. And just, I think, over 70 people, somewhere between 70 and 100 people between the four states had loss of life, particularly in Monette, Arkansas, and then up into, particularly into Kentucky. Most of the deaths happened there. And Bob responded by writing a piece that I'm going to share parts of tonight with some of my own thoughts, again, entitled Enduring and Understanding Storms. And I know that some of you potentially who are watching this, listening to this, are going through some storms, or you're coming out of a storm, or you're getting ready to go into a storm that maybe you don't know about right now. But that pretty well describes all of us to one extent or another. Now, not all storms are not equal. We know that. Some are minor blitzes in the road. Others are life-threatening and life-altering, like these tornadoes. But regardless, let's look at what the Bible says about enduring and understanding storms. And I'm hoping that a friend of mine in Northeast Missouri named April is paying attention to this, because she has a good friend who apparently is in stage four cancer of one kind or another. And my understanding is this individual knows the Lord as their Savior and Lord. But I hope that this can encourage you and help you in some way to minister to this friend of yours, April. And I know many others potentially can benefit from these scriptures and teaching as well. But Bob writes, a little less than a month ago, a vicious storm ripped through western Kentucky, taking the lives of over 70 residents of the Commonwealth of Kentucky. Tragically, seven members of one Bowling Green family were killed in the blink of an eye. Five of them were children. And four members of another household just down the street, and my understanding is, were killed as well. 11 on that one street, I believe. But scores of others were injured. We know there were several killed in a factory collapse in Mayfield, Kentucky. And hundreds of homes were destroyed in what's been termed Kentucky's worst tornadoes in history. And one of them was particularly long track and may have set a record for the distance it was on the ground. But these were supercell tornadoes, far from what we would normally expect to be weather in the United States in December, even in the south or southeast. but it happened regardless. And so that heartbreaking disaster, of course, seemed even worse because it was so close to Christmas time. And my heart just broke when I saw some drone footage of some of the damaged towns and homes, and saw at more than one place Christmas decorations strewn among all the rubble of those homes. It was heartbreaking. Well, what does the Bible teach about severe storms? Are they a sign of the end of times? Are they sent by God to warn us or from Satan to torture us? Are storms evidence of man-made climate change, as some people insist? While the Bible does not answer these questions in detail, we can draw some basic conclusions about how we should respond by studying several terrible storms that are recorded in Scripture. Now, you can go back and rewatch and listen to parts of this as you need to, but I'm going to give you the references to Scripture as I go through. But let's start with Jonah and what he experienced in a terrible windstorm at sea. Instead of going to Nineveh to preach as God had commanded, he boarded a ship that was going in the exact opposite direction. And Jonah 1:4 says, "Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up." And so the runaway prophet confessed to the terrified crew that he was the target of God's wrath, and they could only be spared by throwing him overboard. When the sailors reluctantly complied with his request, the storm stopped. But in his great mercy, God spared not only the sailors, but also Jonah and eventually the Ninevites that he went and preached to. Years later, the Apostle Paul also experienced a horrendous storm at sea while sailing to Rome as a prisoner, according to Acts 27:14, which says the wind of a hurricane force called the Nor'easter swept down from the island. Well, unlike Jonah, Paul wasn't rebelling against God. He was doing exactly what God told him to do, to go to Rome as God intended. However, the Alexandrian ship he was sailing on became trapped in this raging storm that lasted for 2 weeks, causing most on board to lose hope of ever being saved. And during the storm, I want you to notice in Acts 27, Paul did not conclude that he was the target of God's wrath, nor suggest the sailors throw him overboard to stop the storm. Instead, he confidently stood up and announced, "Men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss." Acts 27, verse 21 and 22. In other words, sometimes people experience storms because of the poor judgment of others. Sometimes we all can get caught in the fallout of somebody else's bad decisions in life. A drunk driver hits an innocent family, and there's death or destruction, injury caused to the innocent people who did nothing wrong. They're just going about their lives. And somebody else made a terrible bad choice and end up costing families hurt and grief for decades as a result. That happened to my family. During that time, we find out there in Acts 27, Paul continued, "But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you is going to be lost, only the ship's going to be destroyed." So unlike Jonah's storm that was a judgment from God, Paul's storm was apparently from a natural disaster. During that time of year, fierce storms are common on the Mediterranean. Sometimes violent weather results from a perfect storm, and Christians are not exempt because God does send his rain on the just and the unjust, according to Jesus in Matthew 5:45, the New King James Version says. But then sometimes storms are the result of a satanic attack. So they're caused by our disobedience, our rebellion against God. Sometimes they're caused by somebody else's poor choices, sinful choices. We get caught in the fallout. But sometimes they're a result of Satan attacking. For example, in Job 1:19, records, "Then suddenly a mighty wind swept in from the desert and struck the four corners of the house where Job's 10 children were feasting in the home of the oldest son. And as a result, they all died. They were all crushed. They were all injured fatally because of that storm." All of his kids, all of his children died instantly. I can't imagine that kind of grief. the context of that story implies that it was the devil who, as Jesus says, does come as our enemy to kill, steal, and destroy, who initiated that particular storm. But how do we know? How do we know why cancer happens? Why COVID happens? How can we tell if God is disciplining us or Satan is attacking us or is getting hammered simply because we live in an imperfect world? Sometimes, I mean, unlike Paul, most of us don't receive a direct directive from an angel or a vision, so usually we can't know for sure the exact source every time from difficulties we face, okay? But I suspect most of the time we get hit by storms because we live in a fallen world where the whole creation has been groaning, as Paul writes in Romans 8:22, and storms just can't be completely avoided all the time, okay? Even though we can't immediately interpret the reason for most storms, we can seek to respond with godly wisdom and character regardless of the source of the storm. Regardless of the source, we should be first examining ourselves and our walk with the Lord. Have we, like Jonah, been running from God? Is there a spirit of rebellion in our hearts for which we need to repent? I would encourage you to read Hebrews 12:6. That's Hebrews 12, verse 6. Though we can't always identify the reason for a storm, we can trust that God is going to use it to increase our faith if we cooperate. Jesus' disciples feared they were going to be drowned as a result of a threatening squall on the Sea of Galilee, and they asked Jesus, "Don't you care?" But when Jesus calmed their fierce turbulence with a simple command, "Peace be still," and the wind completely quit and the water completely ceased storming like it was, and the huge waves, I mean, it was still as glass, according to Mark 4:39. They learn to trust Jesus more completely. So although we don't understand perfectly or completely the reason for storms we face or someone that we love faces, we deeply grieve our losses and we wonder where God is, like Job. We can stubbornly affirm, "Though he slay me, yet will I hope in him," in Job 13, verse 15. But we can also look for opportunities to use storms to enhance our witness. But please hear this. Amidst the turbulence, Paul kept his poise and exercised his leadership gifts. He gave testimony to his faith in God. When the storm finally ended and all were saved, Paul's testimony was greatly respected by all 276 people on board that ship. A day after Kentucky's devastating tornadoes, last month, it was encouraging to witness hundreds and hundreds of volunteers converging on Western Kentucky and other places, of course, as well, as a response to offer immediate assistance. It was uplifting to learn that millions of dollars had been donated by sympathizers from across the country. Yet, I think it was most inspiring to see the courageous response of Christ followers who were at ground zero, some who had lost all their earthly possessions, vehicles, and sometimes even people, family members. Scores of believers gave public praise to God for sparing their lives. Church leaders had affirmed to the media that, yeah, our church building's been destroyed, but our church is alive and well. One brief video that's gone viral shows a man in the middle of his roofless house that had been totally trashed by the tornado, and the homeowner sits at a piano that was somehow spared and left intact, and he plays the song, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus." There's just something about that name. And the last phrase of that song reminds us, kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. But that heartwarming video, that testimony, speaks volumes about that man's faith and his priorities. And time again, people said, "Well, you know, all of our stuff's gone. Everything we worked for is trashed. But God spared us. We're grateful for that. We'll rebuild with his help." Now, no one wants to experience an agonizing two-week nor'easter like Paul did, or a horrifying 2-minute tornado. No one wants to experience cancer or COVID. But when ferocious storms charge into your life or the life of a loved one, chances are it's a golden opportunity for you to draw near to God and give testimony to others, as John writes in 1 John 2, verse 17, the little epistle of 1 John, chapter 2, verse 17, the world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever. So I would encourage you who are listening who are in Christ, you know you're saved. You encourage those around you who are experiencing storms, whether they're walking with the Lord or not. You help them all you can. You pray for them. You, even though it's awkward, even though you don't know what to say sometimes to people who know they're dying, I mean, we're all dying. We're all terminal. And I don't say that flippantly, but it's the facts. This is not our home. We're not going to live here forever. None of us are. Jesus is going to come back, or we're going to die and go to be with him if we're in Christ. So, of course, that's the first step, is make sure you're in Jesus. You have obeyed Scripture, and you've turned your life over to Christ as your Lord and Savior. And then you faithfully walk with him. You serve him. And so, again, I'm encouraging you, if you're watching or listening to this, for whatever reason in the past, you've dropped out of church, or you've, through COVID, you've been discouraged from going, of course, when we had to shut down, you know, almost 2 years ago, and you just got out of the habit of going, or whatever your reasons are, get back in church. I don't care if it's not a perfect church. You're not going to find a perfect church here on earth. Get back in church someplace where you can get involved, you can be fed and ministered to. As you serve, you'll be fed more by your serving than just going and listening and soaking up. But serve. Give God your best. Minister to those around you that are hurting for whatever reason. Guard your tongue, your words. Don't be quick to speak, but be quick to listen. And pray about those situations, those people who may not know Christ and may be extremely bitter, or may know Christ and be very angry. Point them to the Psalms, where David many times lashes out and he's very frustrated. He's angry. He doesn't understand why God's allowed certain things to happen. God can take it, okay? God's shoulders are big enough to take your disappointment, your friend's disappointment or hurt. Just be careful what you say. Don't say too much. Listen. Pray with them. And pray about them and for them on a regular basis. And if you know somebody who you think can better connect with them and help them in their needs, whatever that need is, then you help them find that person. You help connect them to that person. There's a lot of things you can do to help people in their storms. But thankfully, in Christ, the sting of death is taken away, and that storm is not going to be, it's not fatal. It is not the end, even if our life is taken here, because we're going to die one time or another, for one reason or another, or Jesus is going to come back first. So, don't lose hope. Make sure you have an assured hope yourself in Christ and that you point other people to him. You immerse yourself in God's word and get involved in church if you're not now. And seek the counsel of other godly, wise, experienced Christians, because almost everybody has experienced storms, most of the time pretty severe storms. Your storms are not mine. Mine haven't been yours, most likely. But we're gonna face storms. Jesus promised that. John 16:33. He said, in this world, you're going to have trouble. He didn't say you might have trouble. Some people are going to have trouble. He said to his disciples, those who are following him, you're going to have trouble, but take heart. I've overcome the world. And so when we are connected to the great overcomer, we're going to be victors in the end, no matter what we face now. So keep looking up, trusting God, walking with Jesus every day. And God bless you.